All right, well, we're going to get started right now with lecture material for this class. As you know, if you signed up for this class, we're going to be talking about severe thunderstorms. We're going to talk about today organized severe thunderstorms. What are the ingredients that foster the development of organized severe thunderstorms? Kind of like a recipe, say, for cookies, for instance. There are certain ingredients you need to have that all come together at the same time and space. Essentially mixing together flour, milk, sugar, eggs, for instance. That's what gives rise to the product that we're trying to create. In this case, severe thunderstorms, we're dealing with a set of ingredients or necessary conditions that must all be simultaneously met in time and space. Now, for those of you who have been in meteorology before, this list of four ingredients is no surprise. If we're going to have clouds, shower, and thunderstorm developments, no surprise, we need moisture to be hanging around in the atmosphere to work. And so we'll consider these units of air known as air parcels, for instance, a lower atmosphere that are relatively moist. If they are forced to rise, they'll be encountering relatively lower pressure in the atmosphere, therefore that they can expand in space, and that is going to be consistent with work being performed on the environment. So using the first law of thermodynamics and assuming minimal energy exchange with the surroundings, work is done on the environment, therefore the internal energy change must be negative. Temperatures cool, eventually we get to the point where the relative humidity breaches 100% and we'll have saturation, the development of clouds, and perhaps eventually thunderstorms, as you can see in this very simple conceptual model here. Another necessary ingredient for thunderstorms to occur is that we have to have instability within the atmosphere, talking in most general terms with the configuration in the vertical temperature profile, with decreasing temperatures at a sufficient rate with height above the ground. And in this particular case, we think of a hot air balloon, just a very basic conceptual model that is rising through the atmosphere. If it encounters relatively cooler temperatures aloft, it's going to have a relatively lower density compared to the surroundings, and it will rise freely on its own without any additional forcing for ascent given meeting certain conditions. And that decrease in temperatures with height can be related to instability. And that magnitude of the decrease in temperatures with height, if it's of a certain condition, we're able to actually get the development of thunderstorms. And so that is another important ingredient, where you have this decreasing potential temperature with height above the ground as the third ingredient for thunderstorms. So we have to have moisture in the air, we have to have lift in the atmosphere, we have to have instability in the background environment. And then lastly, you know, we can get severe thunderstorms out of that, minimally, but for organized severe thunderstorms, we have to have another condition be met, vertical wind shear. We have a change in wind speed, wind direction with height above the ground. In this particular basic example, going off to the right, we have westerly winds that are increasing with height above the ground. That fosters two particular phenomena. Number one, we have horizontal vorticity develop. In this particular case, using the right-hand rule, with increasing westerly flow with height above the ground, you'll curl your hands around like this. The horizontal vorticity vector points, in this case, into the board, in which case eventually we'll have a thunderstorm updraft be superimposed on that horizontal vorticity that then reorients the horizontal vorticity into the vertical to foster the development of vertical vorticity. At the same time, this ingredient of vertical wind shear allows us to have the separation of the updraft from the downdraft such that the unstable inflow to that updraft is not effectively cut off by the strong thunderstorm downdraft related lower theta E air. That separation is critical in the in terms of the updraft to the downdraft. That separation fostered by vertical wind shear is critical for the sustenance and organization of storms, while also allowing for some potential for that horizontal vorticity offered by the vertical shear to be tilted into the vertical and eventually get, as you can see here in this conceptual model, a vertical vorticity associated with a rotating updraft. And we'll talk about all the different processes that give rise to supercells and talk about convective mode later on in this class. So this is our effectively the recipe for organized severe thunderstorms. Just as you have a recipe for cookies, this is a recipe for organized severe thunderstorms. Very basic. Now, the idea here is that, you know, we know meteorology is a lot more complicated than that. You know, just checking off recipes, it's not just making a batch of cookies. There are a lot of different magnitudes. These particular components of this recipe come in different proportions. How much moisture? How much rising air? Through what depth? What degree of instability? What if the vertical shear is really strong and the instability is really weak? What if the vertical wind shear is confined to the lowest levels? How do those modulate the morphology, the characteristics of thunderstorms and the propensity to support severe weather? And that's going to be something we're going to talk about in class. But we're going to effectively transition into right now in terms of this recipe and notion that we have varying proportions of these different ingredients that give rise to severe thunderstorms and result in different convective evolutions and morphologies. We're going to transition into the instability concept and how it can vary, or how the shape of instability can effectively vary between particularly different thermodynamic profiles. What I'm going to show here is a very, very crude conceptual model for two cases. Imagine two skew T log P diagrams here, side by side. The red profile, as you can see here, represents the thermal profile with height, temperature profile with height above the ground. See the same thing here and to the right as well, with the dew point profile in green here, extending upwards from height. And you can see in these particular cases, we'll assume some surface-based cape, for instance, some surface-based partial trajectory with height. We follow a dry adiabat, which you can just imagine superimposed in these diagrams, up to the lifting condensation level over here, which is where we get saturation take place through the processes that I mentioned earlier. And then subsequently, we have condensation take place, so we're not going to be cooling off with height at the same rate as we were following the dry adiabatic collapse rate. Now we have condensation occurring, so we're going, in this particular case, from vapor to liquid water. That's going to be associated with condensation latent heating, since we're going to, in this particular case, a lesser or lower energy state, and so we're going to be giving heat up to the surroundings, so we're going to cool off at a slower rate, and we follow a pseudo-adiabat upwards from the lifting condensation level all the way up throughout the profile, the remainder of the profile. Then once the partial trace, at this point it's cooler than the surroundings, once it becomes warmer than the surroundings, we actually have positive buoyancy, which we can integrate upwards with height from the level of free convection to the equilibrium level through this area here, which traces that what we know as convective available potential energy. This is all review, that's why I'm going through this relatively quickly. Up to the equilibrium level, throughout that entire layer, the virtual potential temperature of the parcel of air is warmer than that of the surroundings, implying lesser density compared to the surroundings, accounting for moisture. And we integrate through all that depth over here in order to give us this quantity called CAPE, as I mentioned earlier, convective available potential energy. And mathematically, that is just going to be the integral from integrating at the bottom, the level of free convection up to the equilibrium level, and then we'll have acceleration due to gravity multiplied by the difference in temperature between the parcel and the environment, considering the virtual temperature, and we'll be normalizing this by the virtual temperature of the environment, integrating with respect to height. And so effectively, we're just looking at the difference here between parcel and environment, virtual temperature, and integrating with height. Now, we're going to do the same thing here to this particular sounding, and you see we get a CAPE profile over here. Well, suppose in reality the CAPE profile gives the exact same magnitude of CAPE. That's entirely possible. It would be entirely correct to say the surface-based CAPE for the left profile is identical to that on the right profile. That's correct, the total magnitude of CAPE. But the thermodynamic profile itself in the environment is not identical between these particular distributions. There's a major difference between the two. In particular, the CAPE in this particular profile here is spread out over a much deeper layer than it is to the left. In other words, the same total CAPE, but it's distributed over a deeper layer with relatively less CAPE in individual finite layers within that positive area depth. So when we're taking all the little chunks upwards with height, we're getting the same net result, but it's not distributed the same. do we get the same type of vertical motion at the convective scale? That's a very important question. The answer is no. So it's not enough just to look at surface-based cape. In other words, not all cape is created equally. We have to consider something about the vertical thermal profile to say more about what's actually going on in the convective scale environment. Biggest difference between these two soundings, cape's the same, but as you can tell, the characteristics of the temperature profile with height above the ground are what are different. In particular, the mid-level lapse rates over here in the left are larger than they are to the right. In other words, the rate of change of temperature fall off with height through the mid-levels is more substantial to the left than to the right. So that gets the idea of environmental lapse rate. The steeper lapse rates to the left support a profile with thicker cape, same magnitude, but thicker cape, and we're going to get a different result as far as the convective process that's involved. So let's think about over here. Let me go back to the slide and talk about what might happen in terms of these differences over here. Clearly, you can see the difference lies in if you were to take a small chunk of depth, a small layer in the atmosphere, we're going to get a different cape magnitude. Even though the total cape is the same, if you took a small finite layer within that cape layer, you're going to get a different amount of cape. So that brings to question what would happen if we were to take the cape and effectively divide it by some finite layer depth within the positive buoyancy profile. Well, let's see through dimensional analysis what might end up happening. We know the units for cape, we're talking about joules per kilogram. And if we're going to be comparing this to something like meters, for instance, we want to get joules per kilogram into something involving meters as well as seconds. Instead of memorizing things, very important part of this class is going to be not memorizing things, but understanding the conceptual models, the meaning, the overarching theory to get at approaches to solving all different types of problems. If we're dealing with joules per kilogram, we're talking about a unit of energy, which can be compared to work over here. We're dividing that out by, in this case, some quantity of mass, joules per kilogram. If we're thinking about work, we're talking about some force, for instance, dotted with some displacement. So work, energy, same general concept. And we're going to be dividing this out by mass. So let's think about physically. Joules per kilogram, energy or work, which is F dot dr, some force applies to over some distance over the mass over here. If we're dealing with force, Newton's second law, mass times acceleration, which is a vector over here, dotted with the displacement vector over here. We're dividing that by the quantity of mass, the denominator. And now what we can see is that the masses effectively fall out over here, and we're left with acceleration dotted with dr. So let's just go straight into dimensional analysis over here to think conceptual about what this means. Acceleration units for that in meters per second squared, dotted with dr, so that's just meters. That yields meters squared per second squared. So in the future, don't memorize cape as, in this particular case, as meter squared per second squared. Know that it's joules per kilogram, and then work your way through physics in order to get what the actual dimensional analysis would tell you the units are. So that's for cape. We know the units for delta z are meters. So we have meter squared per second squared divided by meters, and that will translate over here when we divide out the meters, meters per second squared. So when we take the cape and we consider cape relative to a finite depth within the atmosphere, what that gives us are the units of acceleration. So when we take our positive buoyancy profile and chop it up into a lot of little bits, we're left with vertical acceleration. Well, that's not a particularly big surprise. When we're thinking about effectively the small differences in the depth of the atmosphere where the densities are greater between the environmental air as well as the parcel of air. We're talking about a potentially a larger density difference here in this particular case, a larger deviation from hydrostatic bounds, and therefore a greater upward acceleration owing to the deviation from hydrostatic bounds. So the idea here is that we're going to summarize this into a conceptual model for these particular thermodynamic diagrams. for the short, thick cape case over here, giving the same total cape as the right-hand side, we have a larger what we call cape density, which effectively we're talking about the layer depth over which that cape is present, and that is also going to result in greater upward accelerations, and we know Newton's second law, we can compare that to force, greater upward force in this particular updraft, greater convective scale upward acceleration, and we can actually extend that now to what that means in terms of the real atmosphere. With that greater upward force, there's less opportunity for the environmental, higher density, cooler mid-level air to become entrained into the updraft. If we're applying more upward force, entrainment becomes less of an issue to result in depleting the realized buoyancy. So, you know, entrainment of cooler air, higher density air, that would effectively weigh the updraft down. If we have a background upward force that's much stronger, the effects of entrainment are mitigated to some extent. At the same time, with a stronger upward acceleration, the effects of precipitation drag, that's that weighing down process owing to the downdraft, that effect is mitigated to some extent, and we end up with a stronger updraft in the case of these greater accelerations associated with greater amounts of normalized cape, cape density, et cetera. Whereas in the case of the taller, more narrow cape profile over here, we have a lower cape density. This particular quantity in individual increments of the atmosphere will be smaller. Upward accelerations are going to be weaker, upward force weaker. So water loading and entrainment, those processes that weigh down on those parcels of air, actually have more of an effect on the updraft, and so the realized buoyancy is smaller in that particular case. So this motivates the idea of considering lapse rates. Lapse rates play a major role. If we want to have really stout, robust updrafts with strong upward accelerations, we have to be thinking of lapse rates. So how do we generate lapse rates? How do we change lapse rates with time? How do we go from a weak lapse rate environment to a steep lapse rate environment? And the answer is, we're going to go to the lapse rate tendency equation, and we're going to derive that from first principles. So there's the introduction to class. We're going to transition now to the beginning of the derivations.